Welcome to Open Education International FDP, organized by D.Y. Patil College of Engineering, Akurdi, Pune, under the umbrella of UNESCO and Nova Gorica University, Slovenia. In this FDP, I will be dealing with the topic groundwater sustainability. In the third video of this particular topic, I will be dealing with the actual sustainable solutions. In the previous two videos, I covered the groundwater occurrence and variation, impact of human activities on groundwater and its effects, groundwater quality and its pollution, and how to use the sustainable solutions for the groundwater. Further, I discussed about the causes and effects of groundwater pollution, what are the regulatory authorities, how the groundwater is explored, what are the dangerous part of the country which are most affected, what are the heavy metals in the groundwater which will affect the human life. This particular FDP is based on the program outcome 7 out of the 12 program outcomes for any given program which are defined by the AICTE. Out of that, the PO7 reads for environment and sustainability, in which the students should understand the impact of professional engineering solutions in social and environmental context and demonstrate the knowledge and need for sustainable development. So looking into this particular program outcome, this FDP has been arranged for the Faculty of Engineering and other faculty also. In this particular FDP, more than 30 lectures were delivered from the expert across the world, covering various topics which are based on the 17 sustainable development goals defined by the ISO 40001, which include the green and sustainability IT, green and sustainable power, discussion about the water footprint, eco footprint, carbon credit, environmental impact assessment, mathematics involved in the modeling of earth system, artificial intelligence in sustainable development, job opportunities in this particular field. The total around more than 30 lectures we have listened, and the learning outcomes from these expert lectures are: every person should understand to use natural resource, that is water, food, energy, fuel, in optimum quantity to reduce the individual carbon footprint. That is most essential part of it. So individually, one must think of all these things. Every industry should prepare environmental impact assessment report and follow the act and regulations for the betterment of all stakeholders and become a part of sustainable environment. This includes IT industry also. Ecologically, conscious leaders should empower the community. For example, teachers should empower the students, bureaucrats should empower the organizations, and so on. So all society members should be empowered by this particular thought. Circular economy is very important. It should be achieved in all the sectors of production and manufacturing, considering the life cycle of each product. Green home, green city, green planet should be the agenda of future generations. Education systems should promote the research experimentation by providing centers of excellence, incubation projects, internships in the industries with the funding, creation of job opportunities in the field of environmental consultancy, government and private organizations. These are the learning outcomes that we have come after these more than 30 lectures. The important part here is, in the university curriculum, the students must learn the subject by doing some projects. That is called the project-based learning. Some project-based learning can be done by offering the projects, like students can empowered be by offering the projects which support the environmental sustainability. Many projects at second year level students of the university curriculum for developing attitude towards sustainable environment, like factors affecting environmental pollution and remedies. This can be given at second year level, many projects. At the final year, how to calculate the total green, CO2 emissions for campus. So the green educational campus and calculation for carbon footprint may be the one of the project. Energy and green audit of any industry, design of smart IoT based irrigation systems. These are some projects can be given. Now coming back to the particular topic that I am dealing with, that is the groundwater exploitation or use of groundwater in the different sectors. Here, the holistic approach of ecological footprint should be considered, which considers the carbon footprint and water footprint together. So, in case of the groundwater usage, we have to see how the groundwater is extracted from the aquifer, maybe from a dug well or from borehole. The water is extracted by going down up to the confined or unconfined aquifer, and that groundwater is used for irrigation purpose, industrial purpose, drinking for the cattle feed or mankind, and some of the groundwater goes to the river and some is retained in the aquifer. Now, as far as this particular video is concerned, I will be dealing only with the agriculture use of groundwater. Now, looking to the different irrigation methods for crops, there are many methods. The most traditional method is inundation or flooding method, in which the furrows are formed and the water is given to the crops by flooding. Actually, this method is not sustainable method, and the most sustainable method is the drip irrigation method. About 40% of water is saved in the drip irrigation method compared to the traditional method. Here, in this study, we have to consider the complete life cycle of a crop, that is the total base period of a crop, and when the water is to be given to the crop, at what interval, what amount of water should be given. All these calculations which are given in the crop water requirement can be achieved by the drip irrigation method very efficiently. Now, we shall consider the construction of a borehole or dug well. Here, the construction of a borehole is done by a drilling method. The method is used that a drill hole is there in the earth crust, that is done by a drilling machine which is mounted on a truck, and as the truck moves up to the point where the dug hole is to be created, it is very convenient for digging that hole, borehole, at any place, required place. Of course, for that the groundwater exploration should be done by some technical method, and these boreholes are dug ranging from the diameter 4 inch to 12 inch, and it goes up to depth 30 meter to 200 meter. So actually, beyond 200 meter also sometimes some people go, but there the possibility of having the heavy metals in the groundwater will be increased. Some portion of the loose soil should be cased by providing some strong casing. Now here, while going for the drilling, what particular machinery is used, that compressor is working by taking the energy from diesel engine, and that diesel engine is used as the truck, diesel engine of truck itself. So the study shows that 1 liter of standard diesel fuel creates about 2.6 kg carbon dioxide. So this will give how much liter is required for drilling a hole and how much carbon dioxide is emitted for drilling the hole. Similarly, for big dug well, which ranges from diameter 2 meter to 10 meter with a depth 10 meter to 30 meter, power shovels are used generally, where a JCB, which emits about 9,221 gram per gallon CO2 in the air. So this also gives the estimation of how much CO2 in the construction phase for the dug well will be emitted in the atmosphere. Now, in the conference of Euro-Mediterranean region in 2015, one paper was published. According to that paper and according to ISO 14,041, for drip irrigation system using small diameter plastic pipes as the lateral pipes fitted with emitters, the pipe diameter is 16 mm, external diameter 8 mm thick. Two phases are considered. The first phase is the production of these particular pipes, and the second phase is the use phase. For production of these particular laterals per hectare, the carbon emission is 22,280 kgs per hectare, and in the use phase, 324 kg CO2 emission is there per crop season. Now, looking to this greenhouse gas emission for drip irrigation irrigated land, the CO2 emission is 220 mg per meter square area per hour, and nitrous oxide emission is about 405 microgram per meter square per hour. Now, this is the considerable emission. So to reduce this emission, the traditional methods should not be used, and the drip irrigation method with smart IoTs can be used, where a mobile phone can be used to shut or start the pumps at the site from the any remote place. The sensors are used, moisture sensors are used for any crop. Suppose if the crop requires moisture in the soil ranging from minimum 25 to maximum 75%, then when moisture comes up to 25, the automatically the sensor gives the starts the motor, starts the pump, and the water is applied. When it reaches up to 75%, automatically the motor will be stopped. So using this IoT system, we can use judiciously as per the requirement of crop water to that particular crop. One case study in Egypt shows when we use a diesel engine or electric pump to extract water from the borehole or dug well, the CO2 emission per unit volume of water pumped, for the diesel engine it is 0.99 kg, and for electric pump it is 0.02 kg. So obviously nowadays diesel engines are obsolete, nobody uses diesel engine. As far as the cultivated area is considered, again, diesel pump gives 6.55 ton per hectare, and electric pump just 0.17 ton per hectare. So much reduction is there when the electric pump is used. And as far as operating cost is concerned, diesel pump cost is more than electric pump. Maintenance cost is also more for diesel pump. So the electric pump is the best option. Now, instead of using electricity from the grid, a solar pump is used. That will give again more efficient sustainable solution for the drip irrigation system. Therefore, considering all these factors, we can arrive at a particular carbon footprint for land irrigated by drip irrigation system. The studies in the Egypt shows that as far as different crops are concerned, the CO2 emissions are given here in ton per meter per mm cube per hectare, and according to the type of crop, the variation in CO2 emission is shown in this chart. This chart shows the three different areas are tested, and the CO2 emission is different for the different areas also. So it depends on the location. The CO2 emission depends again on the location also. We can see the red marked area has got the maximum one, and here it is also shown that the one crop wise also it changes, the rice has got the maximum emission. So here it is shown crop wise, so crop wise also and location wise also the CO2 emission changes. So we can conclude like a circular economy in agriculture sector can be achieved through the application of irrigation water by drip method using recyclable components, solar pumps and IoT based operation system. Blockchain concept will lead to sustainable solution to overcome the exploitation of groundwater. So this is about the sustainable groundwater. Thank you.